So two dicks walk into a casino. I love you too! Me or him? Or both of us?
Which dick?
We have a t-shirt coming.
Which dick do you like more?
I love it.
Along the beaches and the way your hair would glisten in the sun, rising in the afternoon, making love to you under the moon. Oh, yeah. Do you remember all the nights we spent in silence? Every single breath you took was mine. We can have it all again. Say that you'll be with me when the sun brings your heart to mine.
Miles.
Hot
to the wet. The smell of your skin can light up all the fires. Hungry to touch, eager to please. Out of control, I hand you the keys. Every night I am burning to make love to you. He shudder and shake, sink your teeth in my skin. I can almost believe you were made to be played by my hand. You got the power, it amazes me still. How you play my emotion with consummate skill. I don't have to look any further than into your eyes.
Appreciate you guys showing up and selling out this room for us tonight. And to my buddy Rick Springfield, I want to say to you, in front of these fine folks, I want to say to you that I love you. We've been friends for almost 40 years, and I'm so happy to be out here on the road with you. But more importantly, I want to thank you for letting me go first on these shows. Because for me, personally, whenever there's more than one dick involved, I want to be the first dick. So, thanks for that.
You're most welcome, Richie. It gets bluer.
Now listen, we have a lot of songs to play for you guys, but unlike most of our shows, we have a curfew to adhere to.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I know. Well, there's nothing we can do about it. If you want to pay the fine, we'll keep playing.
Yeah, it's fine. If we don't get to, right here waiting on Jesse's girl, they're going to fine us like 10 grand if we go over.
I think we're safe. We'll be good. But we might be just moving along a little faster than we normally do. So we're going to give you everything we got, but you should maybe come see us again later. All right, so
play more songs.
Some of you guys might know, but a lot of you might not know that the first job that I ever had in the record business when I was 18 years old, I grew up in Chicago and I moved to LA when I was 18, and the first job I ever got in the record business was singing background vocals for Lionel Richie. I'm 18.
I think that's above the legal limit for baby fat.
Before I knew what a jawline was, but...
You weren't shaving.
So, I had this great opportunity that Lionel afforded me. He brought me in to sing background vocals on his records. And so I tell you this because next time you guys are driving in your cars, or you're at the CBS or whatever, and you hear Lionel go, "All night long, all night." That's me. All night long, all night. That's me. I swear to God. That shit is on Wikipedia. You can look it up. It's true. So, flash forward like a dozen years. Now, you know, a few years later, I got a record deal, and then I was very fortunate to have, you know, hits of my own and put out records, and I was making an album, and I called Lionel Richie and I said, "Hey, would you come and sing background vocals on my record?" And he said, "Yes." And then we were in that room cutting this song, which I'm about to sing for you, and I realized before that that there's a third harmony part on this song. So I called Luther Vandross. I still can't believe my freaking life, but so grateful. This is called The Way She Loves Me. Look in her eyes, and I'm helplessly falling. I'd give all of somebody else when a piece of her heart's there. She knows me better than I know myself. Let me tell you about the way she loved it. Who want the world to know? Crazy about the way she loved it. This train passed me by, just like a fool second guessing. I could have spent my life wondering why I didn't cherish the blessing. She loved me, ooh,
Alright, so everybody alright? George, you gotta put all my guitars out of tune now. Alright, isn't this pretty? You know, when I was a kid, I had to save up money. We had to save up for months to buy a guitar. And then once you become known, they give them to you. I got this given to that's a beautiful guitar.
Right.
It's crazy. I mean, why should work the reverse, right? Like, you have to buy drugs when you're young, but when you're famous, they give it to you for free. Just kidding. All right. It's the first song I wrote for Working Class Doll.
All right.
Hey.
Yeah, exactly.
Baby, tonight, go ahead, just make trouble, it'll be alright. I'm working hard, I don't know why. I'm like a working class dog, and I just get by. Tonight, I'm crawling out from bed. I'm nowhere, living on the brain. Second by minute by minute. Love is alright tonight. Stop and it stops it all. I know the world's going crazy over here. I hope it holds together for one more night. Tonight I'm crawling up from the dead. But no, we're living on the brink. Second by minute by minute. Love is alright tonight.
Thank you, Georgie. Thank you very much, folks. Georgie has a lovely baby. I wish we had a video of it. It's great to have new babies in the world, you know?
Here's a song that I wrote when I had, I think, maybe the most awesome fluffy mullet ever.
My Lord.
Wait, Wait, you're mocking the show. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay, fair enough.
We did the mullet pretty good.
Yeah, we made the mullet look good.
Could have been worse.
Could have gone a whole other direction. Wow. I mean, they actually got up that morning and said, uh-huh, this looks good. I look good.
This is called Satisfied! Maybe you're not very good at it. Or maybe you're a badass at it and you want to show me how good you are at it. I'll make it easy. Just repeat after me. Are you ready? I think you weren't warmed up. Now you're warmed up. Try it again. Try to put some stank at the end of that one. Like, oh, now I'm trying after the voice. That was good. One more. Are you ready? So fucking proud of you right now. That was badass!
Don't you know? Yeah. Ain't gonna stop until I'm satisfied. Don't you know? No. Ain't gonna stop until I'm satisfied.
That's right.
Don't you know? Ain't gonna stop until I'm satisfied.
The way we're singing and the way we're playing, sometimes you look at each other at the wrong line.
I am kind of cute, though.
You are very cute. Those shots around here, dude, they are so great. Alright, so I don't have very many friends. Richard has a lot of friends. I'm very impressed with all Richard's friends. I'll say, hey, I really like this guy. Oh yeah, he's a good friend of mine. Yeah, I love Rod Stewart's voice. Hey, he's a good friend of mine. Yeah, I met Ringo once. Oh, he sent me a birthday card. So I don't have many friends, but my other friend is Sammy Hagar. And we have a Peach Bar Rum company together, if anyone drinks rum. Please try Cola Spice. It's fucking awesome. So anyway.
Do we have some backstage by chance?
No, but dude, we should, you know, I mean.
I mean, you're the owner.
Share it.
Is that, can I get a little rum backstage, dude?
I say shots for everybody.
Where's my phone? I'll call him after the show. Okay. So I had a bunch of demos in 1979. I was flying up for this guy, Keith Olsen, who was a brilliant producer back then. And he was offered to produce two songs with me, and he picked one song, was called... No, we're not doing it yet. And
I thought that was like... Feelings.
That was the other song he brought. He brought me Feelings, and I said, nah, I don't think so. It's not gonna be him. but he brought this one song, this other song, outside song, and I said, I consider myself a songwriter. I don't know if I want to do someone else's song, but it was Sammy Hagar's song, and I'm very glad that I decided to fucking do it.
And you just take it like I can't take a thing. I'm giving up on love this time. Me and my friends will do just fine. Sing it!
I want everything for you.
You don't like the body, I've done everything for you. You don't like the body. You do something. And have a whole lot of money, I'd be a millionaire. When that didn't happen overnight, I found out how much you really cared. All you want is a whole lot of money. All the rest is just garbage, sweet parts. I've done everything for you. Sing it!
You've done nothing for me.
I've done everything for you. You've done nothing for me.
Yeah.
met you, you didn't know how to love a man. All those sins about making love, you didn't understand. Now you know about everything. Town tonight and get as wild as I can be. I'm gonna find out what it'll be like to be loose and free. But I don't care what the people say. I'm making my mind up, changing to stay.
I've done everything for you.
See you later. You got nothing for me.
I've done everything for you.
You done nothing for me.
Show that it's a very different vibe than just being up by yourself, to be with a friend and to have, you know, like camaraderie and kind of jokes, and it's really makes it more fun. I'm really digging it.
We are having a blast. Speaking of that, my friends, I feel like even though we're only a few songs in, I feel like we have a bond.
Hell yeah!
We would hang out. I feel like if Rick and I were like, hey, come back to the Travel Lodge.
Yeah!
You guys be like, yeah!
Okay.
You got a nice pool.
Yeah.
Really a chemical bath.
That is so real.
But I feel like we have a bond. Plus, it's Saturday night. And I feel like this is the perfect moment for me to sing you a song about a girl who got murdered. I see. Some of you already know what this song is. So I wrote this song back in 1990.
Wow.
I was out on this really long tour, and it's one of the only times, it may be not the only time, that I ever dreamed a song where it woke me up out of a sound sleep. We've talked about this. It's happened to you like once or twice. So I dreamed, not the lyrics, but the music woke me up out of a sound sleep. The complete piece of music, all the melody, the chords, everything. I dreamed it. And I was in the back of this tour bus.
So God co-wrote it.
Yes. So I wake up in the back of this tour bus, and it's all there. I can hear everything. I can hear what the bass is playing, what the drums are doing, everything. So I immediately reached for my Panasonic cassette recorder. Because it was 1990. And I sang all the music into the tape machine so I'd remember it. And then I started to just play it back and listen to it. And because that's how I write. I write music first, almost always. And then I let the music kind of tell me what the lyrics should be about. And this song immediately wasn't a love song. It wasn't a fun, up-tempo rock and roll song. There was something haunting about it and mysterious about it. And so I thought, how badass would it be if I could write a murder mystery to this piece of music? And so I was like bound and determined, just as a songwriter, to grow, to stretch. I'd never written a song, a story song, with characters and a plot. And I gotta tell you, it's fucking hard to write a whole story in 4 minutes. But I was like bound and determined, and I worked and worked and worked on it. And the more I worked on it, the bigger a piece of shit I thought this song was. But I worked so hard on it that I had to record it just for my own pride. And I recorded it, and I thought, I put it on the album I was putting out, and I thought, you know what, it'll be this album cut. Remember album cuts?
Yeah.
Remember albums?
Before.
Yeah. I thought it would be like, I thought it would be like track nine.
Yeah.
You know, something that just be a little artistic thing. Well, 6 months later, the song was number one in 14 different countries. And it's called Hazard.
Thank you.
I started going on the road, I think, when I was 17.
When I was 17.
I ended up in Vietnam, actually, in 1968-69, playing for the American troops. Didn't expect that one, but...
Wait. You're Australian, though, right?
Yeah, yeah, but they because they would pick Australians because we were closest Occidental country to Vietnam.
You're Australian. Sometimes I forget that you're Australian.
I'm Australian. Yeah.
By the way, how do you like America?
I'm sorry, I don't speak English really very well. Could you repeat the question?
Sorry.
So when stuff started to happen in the 80s, I hit the road. And I was being a bit of a bad boy out there because there were a lot of offers that I never had before. I know, and I was walking down the street and nobody noticed me. And 1981, suddenly it was all different. It can turn a young guy's head, definitely. And which it's okay, but I had a girlfriend, so it wasn't cool. But luckily, there is forgiveness in the world, and that girlfriend became my wife. And I'm very thankful for that. But while I was being a bad boy, I thought, you know, she was maybe doing the same thing back home, but she wasn't, because she's good spirit and didn't do those kind of things. But I thought she was. So I wrote this song about her from the perspective. Is that a good word? Yeah. Perspective.
It's good. It's good.
Okay. Did I say that correctly?
You said it correctly. Okay.
From the perspective of my sexual paranoia. When you were just a young girl in film and school, I come and never look a golden rule. Don't talk to strange men, don't be a fool. I'm hearing stories, I don't think that's cool. Why don't you tell me someone is loving you? Cause you're my girl, some say it's along the trail. You're seeing some slick continental dude. I'm begging you, sing it!
Don't talk to strangers.
Wow. That was awesome.
So tell me, how's life in the big city? I hear the competition talk, baby, that's a pity. And every man, actor, every girl is pretty. Yeah, I don't like what's getting back to me. Now's the done one I've been hearing of. Love hurts, but only one's in love.
It's fucking awesome. All right, I'll do the French bit. You ready?
Fais l'amour avec moi. Viens dormir, mon amour. Je t'aime de moi, ton corps ce soir.
Original part.
Don't talk to strangers.
Baby, don't you talk.
Don't talk to strangers.
You know it'll only use you will.
Don't talk.
That was awesome.
You're
very good on the move.
Damn right.
All right. So everybody's still good? All's good? So I've been very fortunate over the last 50 decades or so. Louder.
Hold on to
the memory. Holy shit. Wow, you guys can sing.
I'm wishing I could keep.
You all sang in tune. That was incredible.
That was awesome.
Yeah, that's it.
Well, so I wrote that song in the late 80s, and that song, to this day, has become like the number one prom theme. It's about cheating. But even now, like, millennial 18-year-olds are like, hold on to the lights. Oh my God, I'm gonna miss you in homeroom. Whatever, that's fine.
You're a great millennial, dude.
But I've also, I've written a few songs over the years that have become sort of wedding songs, wedding anthems. I wrote a song for the group NSYNC a long time ago called This I Promise You, which has like been used at so many weddings. And I wrote a song that I did called Now and Forever that's been used at a ton of weddings. And so this is a true story. Like, not long ago, I was out on the road, and I had just enough time to go from soundcheck back to my hotel, change, and get ready to come back for the show. And I'm going up the elevator, and halfway up to my floor, the doors open, and this couple gets on. And they go, oh my God, Richard Marx, oh, it's so nice to meet you. Hey, nice to meet you too. And the wife looks at me, she goes, this is so crazy that we're meeting you. We used your song at our wedding. And I looked at them and I said, was it Should Have Known Better?
Just a faded memory.
Okay, one more chorus. All you. It's all you. Let me hear you. Go.
Should've known better.
I'm gonna give you all a little alone time with my friend Rick Springfield here for a song. Freshen up my drink, and I'll be back in a few minutes. Love you, mean it.
Here
he is. Richie. I never thought he'd leave. I'm from convict stock. Oh, did I lose you, dude? That usually stops them. They go, whoa, I sat through an hour of that shit. I'm not going to miss that song. All right, go for me, would you? Thank you. So, they used to have this thing in England called the transports, where if you stole anything under 2 shillings, they wouldn't kill you. They wouldn't hang you. They'd put you on a ship once they discovered Australia, and they'd ship you to Australia. And that's where you'd live the rest of your life as a convict in Australia. It was fucking brutal. They'd chain them to the bottom of the ship, just like the way they brought the slaves over from Africa. Chain them and half of them would die. It was a 6-month journey. And I recently found out that my ancestors came over like that. Do we have the, check it out. William Springthorpe. Up there, because my family name is Springthorpe. How many people know that? It was changed by the... Oh, my God, I'm losing another one. Dude, don't wear a white shirt when you have to go to the bathroom in the middle of the show. What the fuck? Go for me. Or bring a beer back if you're going... He's going, oh, no, I feel hot now. Oh, they're back. Okay. We need to sit down. And so... Oh, he's going off again. Enjoy the show. So anyway, assault and robbery. This was William Springthorpe in the 1800s. Assault and robbery, sentenced to life, and he was sent to Australia. And you're wondering, if he's sentenced to life, well, how was I born, right? If he's spending his life in prison. But check this out. I also found this. Extracts from Descent to Tasmania, which is a little island down the bottom. Information is requested respecting William Springthorpe, who arrived in this colony in 1844 and was last heard of in 1851. The fucker escaped. That's why I'm here. Thank you, William. All right, so my dad was Norman Springthorpe. And I'm going to do a song for my dad tonight. It's called My Father's Chair. And my dad died in 1981 from cancer. And wow, we just lost a friend tonight also from cancer. Her name is Carrie. Until tonight, this song is for you, Carrie. My dad was dying. He would sit in this blue leather rocking chair and he'd watch cricket, you know, the English game, not that little black insect, you know. And he watched cricket, which is a horrible game. It was like baseball on Percocet. And my dad loved cricket, and he'd watch cricket. And When he finally passed away, I went home for the service, and I went into that room, and I happened to see his chair sitting there, and I realized for the very first time that he wouldn't be coming home. And that's the hardest realization for me. The death is kind of like, you just can't grasp it. But when you finally realize that they aren't coming home, that hit me hard. And so I remember that image of the chair, and 3 years later I finally got up to get it enough to write a song for my father, called My Father's Chair. And tonight, as I said, this one is for Carrie. God bless you, Spirit. And for your lost ones as well. My father's chair still standing there, all alone since the long night. Now it's 3 years on, and I still feel he'll come home, we'll be alright. Oh, where's this healing time brings? I was told the pain would ease, but it still hurts like the first night. My mother and I were looking up at a distant star and wishing we could reach that far. Back in the house and alone for the first time, told each other we care, and we avoided my father's chair.
Continues counting down all the while, and every child shared a long night.
But do the spirits meet again? Why am I still so filled with doubt? Is my soul everlasting? In the far distant future, when I knew you'd be gone, came too fast, but stays too long. Why do they leave the weak of spirit and take the strong? When the world turns sour and I get sick from the smell, and I can't find no comfort there, I climb into my father's chair.
My buddy Richard Marks is back on stage.
Cheers to Norman! And to you. All right, well, we're going to go from fathers to sons. So I'm going to do one song for you on my own here, but I'm going to be helped out by my sons. I have three sons.
Oh, and they're
the Marx Brothers. And no, they're not physically here with me here in Bensalem, but so this is a song I wrote about a dozen years ago. I write most of my songs by myself, but this one I wrote with one of my best friends, like my brother, he's my the brother I never had. I'm an only child. This is my brother, and his name is Matt Scannell from the band Vertical Horizon. And we wrote this song about a dozen years ago when my sons were late teens, early 20s. And when I wrote and recorded this song, all three of my sons made a point to tell me, independently of each other, that they really loved the song. And by that I mean, they looked at me and were like, yeah, I like that one. That's as excited as they got. And any of you guys who have kids, you know, like, if you get the slightest praise from your fucking spawn, it's like seeing a unicorn, right? So here's the thing. I have three sons, and they are all three not only just the most kind, awesome, thoughtful, soulful dudes. They're my best friends. But they're also really talented singer, songwriter, musicians. And they all live near me in LA. So I called them up a while ago and I said, you guys, I got an idea. I'm going out and doing all these shows, these acoustic shows. It'd be really cool if we could go into a studio and re-record that song that you like. Only this time, you guys play all the instruments because my sons all play different instruments. So we did. We went in the studio and we re-recorded this song and I filmed them doing their parts. So you're going to see my eldest son, Brandon, who's 33. And I just threw up in my mouth a little bit. He's playing guitar and singing harmony to me. And my middle son, Lucas, who's 31, he's playing piano and singing harmony to me. And my baby boy, Jesse, who just turned 30 2 weeks ago, playing drums and singing harmony. And I'm gonna sing and play live to the video of my boys for you guys right now. This is called When You Loved Me. Back at the corner where we say goodbye, I turn and I see you, but don't trust my eyes. You love me. I can't breathe.
both have boys. That's
thank you.
Except they're cutting it down.
I gotta get him through a little bit of this too. This is this brew that portion of the evening. This is the stuff that I've been drinking for my voice for years. And so any of you here who use your like public speakers, singers,
oh my God.
Bus drivers,
yeah.
School teachers, mother or grandmother of screaming kids. This is the best voice restoration concoction. Everyone, I'm gonna tell you. You think I'm not gonna say what it is?
What is it?
Here's what it is. It's this much lemon juice and about that much heroin.
Water.
I'm kidding. It's crap.
Water.
Oh my God.
Now it's this much lemon juice and a little layer of ginger, powdered ginger.
Oh yeah, that's good.
Some honey to sweeten it, and then, very important, a whole bunch of cayenne pepper.
Oh yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So yeah. Cheers.
Where's the crap?
Oh wait, before you go on, can I tell you a quick story really quick? So this, it's like, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago.
That's what we do.
I get this text from Brian Adams. Now, Brian Adams and I are not besties.
Oh, sure.
But we've met a couple of times over the years. And I see this, I'm like, Brian Adams is texting me. And the text, I swear to God, he goes, dude, I'm in Milwaukee. And I've got a show in 4 hours, and my voice is gone. What's that shit you drink? And I was so psyched to hook him up. I was like, I got you, Brian Adams. And I texted him the recipe, and I was like, okay, and then you do this, and you put this much in, and you stir it up, and you put it in the microwave for 45 seconds. And then, okay, so here's the thing. This same exact concoction can also be used as a cleanse. Wait! And the difference between using it as a cleanse versus using it for your voice is for a cleanse, you drink it. But for your voice, you just sip it. And I totally forgot to tell Brian Adams that part.
It was a very short show that night.
Because that's the kind of friend I am.
So, I did a movie called, Hard to Hold. I'm still trying to make up for that one. Anybody see, Supernatural? Anyone see me? How about Californication? Anyone see it?
That was awesome.
I saw that a photo from that online, and I was like, oh my gosh. Okay, that's enough. Dude, I don't remember being in a porno movie. It was insane because it was a crazy show, and they just wrote I said they wanted me to play Rick Springfield, only a guy named Rick Springfield with my
not to interrupt, but one of my favorite things about you being in that show, because I loved that show anyway, and then when you showed up in it and David Duchovny's character in every scene he's in with Rick calls him Rick Springfield. Like, there's a moment where he goes, why are you being such a fucking dick, Rick Springfield? So from now on, every time I see you in the morning, I'm gonna be like, morning, Rick Springfield.
Why are you such a dick, Rick Springfield? David actually made that up on the spot. It was one of those kind of shows where, you could just do stuff. And so I was, the whole sex scene was totally orchestrated, and we were covered, but it looks pretty. I'm glad my mom never got to see it. Let me say that. So I've done other stuff. I did. Still trying to make up for Hard to Hold. You liked it?
It was a blast.
I did a movie with Meryl Streep, and it didn't do as well as Hard to Hold. The fuck? So anyway, I'm doing Hard to Hold. I'm making filming Hard to Hold. And Patty Hansen is my co-star. And she is was Keith Richards from the Stones' girlfriend. And now she's his wife. And it's got to be a wild relationship. So, Patty was great. I really liked her, and we got along well. We, you know, talked during shots, and I guess Keith heard about it. Came down to the set of Hard to Hold to see what was going on with his girlfriend and this Rick Springfield guy. I turned into a 14-year-old girl. Oh my God! It's Keith Richards. Get the camera. And we.
Oh wow! What a flattering picture of Keith Richards. Yeah.
He got photo approval on that. And yeah, he looks like Dracula, which is, you know, correct. Every time you smoke a cigarette, God takes a year off your life and gives it to Keith Richards. I saw this photo the other day in the magazine. It was Keith with his two young daughters. They're like, I don't know, 30 or 35.
That was good.
Did he have photo approval of that?
He knew they were taking that photo. And he's standing with these two young daughters, and the caption is, "When they die, everything they own will be his." So, anyway, so this is from Hard to Hold. See, the opinions about the movie, but I like the song. So, it's called, what's it called?
Feeling.
Nothing more.
It's called, should I introduce it? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Rick Springfield singing Love Somebody!
Hey! I can see the path you're cutting. Got me a little piece of my heart. I can see the doors you're shutting. 'Cause they're open at the start, baby. Loving you's been hard on me. You're a tough little sister, but you'll settle for a mister tonight.
She knows how to bite. 'Cause when you fit our plan, you got the perfect image of the perfect man. You're a tough little sister, but you'll settle for a mister tonight. But you're right out of time. You better love somebody. It's late, you better love somebody.
Saying what I feel.
You think I'm a rhino?
I was sleeping at the wheel.
I thought that you were driving. You better love somebody. You better love somebody. You better love somebody.
Thank you.
That's the scan from the brain. And check this out. This is very weird. And I highlighted it so you could see it really closely. This is my initials in my brain.
Dude, that looks like it could be Paul Stanley's brain.
No, it's clearly an R, Richie. I wrote the...
Then it could be Rod Stewart's brain.
Ringo Starr, let
me Ringo Starr's brain. I call bullshit.
No, seriously. Seriously, that's absolute. I sent it to. I have another friend up in Richard. His name's Doug Davidson. He's from Young and Restless. And I sent it to them, and they actually spotted it. They said, "Is this really your brain? Because your initials are actually in your brain." So it's real. Anyway, that's why I forgot. I didn't forget. It just every now and then it goes like that. And who are you again? You guys
where
are really
am
familiar.
I?
We've met, right?
Constant.
All right.
guys for being here tonight. And thanks to whoever grabbed me inappropriately by thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Alright, are you guys ready for one more from me and one more from the other band? You don't sing along with this, I'm coming back out there.
What's that? you.
Yeah.
Do you have any other songs you have?
Jersey is a friend. Yeah, I know it's been a good friend of mine. But little something's changed, it ain't hard to define.
Jersey's got himself a girl and a wannabe of mine.
And she watching him with gold eyes. And she loving him that body I just know. And he's holding her in his arms late at night.
You know I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I wish that I had Jesse's girl. Why can't I find a woman like that?
I put him up with the charade. There doesn't seem to be a reason to change. You know, I feel so dirty when they start talking cute. I want to tell her that I love her, but the body's
from the moon.
But she's watching him with those eyes. And she's loving him with that body. I just know it. He's holding her in his arms lately at night. You know, I wish that I had
Jesse's girl.
I wish that I had.
Thank you so much for coming out.